All right, there we are. We are live. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Oh, you sound all very depressed. Maybe the live stream will be a little more lively. Good morning to everyone on our live stream around South Africa. So this morning is development seminar morning. This is very exciting for me because it's not a rehash of one of the old development seminars, which we do occasionally, but it is a brand new development seminar, and I really enjoy getting stuck into these development seminars. And my hope, as is my hope for every development seminar that we deliver, is that you will attach yourselves to maybe just one or two of the principles that we're going to be discussing this morning. And hopefully that'll cause some introspection. We all, I think, appreciate that changing oneself, bettering oneself, is not something that happens overnight. It is certainly a process. And the process always begins with self-awareness. It begins with understanding who you are and who you want to be, and creating some hope, and then working on that to resolve the aspirations that you have in mind. So that is my hope for everyone this morning. Our dev seminar is called Reaching the Top 1%. We're going to uncover this topic a little bit this morning. It is a little bit ambiguous, but I will reveal the ambiguity in the title a little bit later in the presentation. So let's begin. We start with the story of Icarus. Does everyone know the story of Icarus? Yes, some know, some yes. You might recount the story as being, well, let me tell you what the story is. The story of Icarus is him and his father were imprisoned on an island in Greece. It's a Greek mythological story. And Icarus's father, Daedalus, he fashioned these wings for him and his son to escape the island. Right? And when he gave the wings to his son, he warned his son. He gave his son a warning. He said to his son, do not fly too close to the sun. So in other words, don't fly too high. Because if you fly too high, the wax that I've used to bond the feathers into your wings, they will melt and then you will fall to your death. But there's an interesting thing about this story, because the original story, right? We're going back 16th, 15th century. The original story, the father warns his son, more importantly than flying too high, beware flying too low. Because if you fly too low, the moisture from the ocean will get into your wings. It'll weigh your wings down, and then you will fall to your death too. Why has the story evolved differently? We look at industrialization in the last 200 years. The story started to change with the advent of industrialization. Industrialists needed people who would perform in the middle, right? They didn't want people performing too high, having too great aspirations. And so they took that part of the story out. They said, it's fine to fly low. Don't be worried about flying low. Flying low feels a lot safer, doesn't it? It was the same time that public schools came into be. Did you know that public schools only came into be when industrialization kicked off? Why did that happen? Again, industrialists needed workers. Blue-collar, white-collar workers. People with low aspirations. People that would conform to the requirements of the new industrial age. Right? And so the story is, the lesson to us is, beware of flying too low. This safety net of employment that we've come to know is no longer a safety net. Employment doesn't offer safety anymore. We have to start aspiring for more. We are allowed to start dreaming bigger, to having bigger aspirations, right? There's nothing wrong with trying to fly too high. It is safer than flying too low. Right? Great story to begin with. So the top 1% globally, when we talk about, this is where I get onto the ambiguity of the title, the top 1%. What does that mean? What does it mean to be in the top 1%? Well, globally, if you compared yourself to the rest of the population across the world, to be in the top 1% would mean that you would need an asset value of about 770,000 US dollars, about 10 million rand. So the question is, well, is this something we aspire to? This is a question you'll have to ask yourselves individually. Do I aspire? Would I aspire? Is this dev seminar Britain Rob's giving me, is there any value in aspiring to having 10 million rands worth of asset value? Right? For me, the answer is no. No, that's not a number you have to aspire to. If we look at it in the context of DuePoint, what does it mean to be the top 1% of DuePoint? Well, I can define it for you, right? Because we got all the statistics. I can tell you the top 1% of DuePoint perform in a certain fashion that has allowed them to reach rank 2 within 2 years and earn around 25,000 rand within 2 years. So as wealth engineers, does that become an aspiration? I think so for most of us, or perhaps that's something we tell you, aspire to achieving rank 2. And this is just the journey. You're not limited. Rank 9 is not the end of the road at DuePoint. It's just a dot in the journey of being a 1%er, right? Within 2 years, you can achieve rank 9. You can achieve earning about 25,000 rand a month. Those are great aspirations. But I want to take the self-awareness further, right? I want to understand what motivates people around their motivations. This is something you should be aware of. What motivates you? Have you ever asked yourself the question? We don't have a lot of alone time today anymore with the advent of technology, televisions, all these things, family, kids yapping in your ear all the time when you're at home, right? When do you have time for some reflection and self-awareness? The point is that when we talk about being in the top 1%, you might be thinking, well, now I'm competing with the other 99%. Have you ever thought that? To be 1%, you've got to beat the 99%, right? Oh, this is problematic. My kids are very young. My daughter's turning 6 soon. My son's just over a year. The question of education comes up constantly. What school are we going to send our kids to? If you have the luxury of even choosing what school your kids can go to. What kind of education do you want your kids to have? And this topic started to surface constantly when we were questioning education, the competitiveness of the modern schooling system. You've got to beat the other kids to feel appreciated. Do you have to beat the rest of the world to define yourself as a winner? You don't? Think about that a little more. Would you be happy coming 35th instead of first? Would you? No? Now the answer's no. So you're saying, yes, I do have to compete, right? But I want you to think about this because this is not something that will suddenly change your mind overnight. This is, again, me stirring that self-awareness pot. How do you motivate yourself? Do you motivate yourself and gain value, self-belief from the result of beating other people? Or are you a person that aspires just to becoming a better version of yourself? And so, I've got a great little story for you. There's a lady. Her name is Gabriella Anderson Scheiss. I'm going to show you a little video. She competed in the 1984 Los Angeles Olympics, the first female marathon in the Olympics ever. And we're going to see whether she gained any value out of winning or just being the best version of herself. So take a look at the video.
My big worry was the humidity. You just try to put it aside and just concentrate on your race. My head and everything was still functioning. I knew where I had to go, and through dehydration, your body cramps up. I kind of told myself, try to keep running, try to stay upright. My muscles just didn't respond. I knew if I would stop or sit down, that would be the end of it. I just was determined to make it to that finish line. I just got dehydrated, and that's why the loss. When I got into the stadium, from you know, the heat was more intense in there. And also at that point, through dehydration, your body cramps up. And that was my main problem. My head and everything was still functioning. I knew where I had to go, and I kind of told myself, try to keep running, try to stay upright, and my muscles just didn't respond. And so then, you know, it just deteriorated over the last 400 meters. At that point, it was just, I'm in the Olympics, I want to finish this race because this is my one and only chance. I think just from the heat in that stadium, I just started to fall apart. But I clearly remember the cheering and the noise. It was just incredible. It was so loud. I didn't expect something like that. So that was, you know, clearly I can hear that, and that probably kept me going too. There was a doctor. He was following me closely and watching me. And later on, you know, he said, because there was a lot of criticism from the press, they say, oh, they should have stopped me and things, but I was very relieved and I was, you know, happy I got to the finish line. You know, now looking back with time, I can see that people kind of identify with you, and because they see the struggle and they see that if you really set your mind to it, you can overcome a lot of obstacles. So that, you know, and it teaches you a lesson too, that besides overcoming obstacles, you have to get over some bad experiences and not dwell on it and just look forward and learn something, hopefully learn something from it.
What a great story, right? The lesson in that story is about us to stop competing ourselves against other people, instead to focus on bettering ourselves. The one is motivated by ego. The other one is just trying to do the best that you can do. And there's way more value, and it is more sustainable to be motivated by trying to better yourself instead of competing against everyone else. Except in our work environments, when there's 10 million unemployed people, are you in a competitive environment or just an environment where everyone's trying to do their best? You're in a competitive environment, right? We are competing for jobs. At DuePoint, it is not a competitive environment. We can have as many rank nines as we want. We don't at the end of the year say, okay, only the top 5 people at DuePoint become rank nines. We say if you earned your rank 9 spot, you deserve your rank 9 spot. And so you're an environment here where we want people to aspire to just being the best version of themselves. Humans lead with belief. Now, this is a topic that I touched on at the Converge conference. Well, I didn't touch on it. I expanded on it a lot at the Converge conference, and I want to introduce it again. If we look at the description by Dr. Bobby Hoffman, he says, self-belief is the assessment we make about our personal capabilities and what outcomes we expect as a result of our efforts. This is the core of self-belief. Self-belief can be broken into further categories. Control. This is how you believe what control you have over your destiny. Some people don't believe they have any control over their destiny, and so they're stuck in the mud. If you don't believe that you can control what the outcome is, well, you're going nowhere. Competency. These are presumed competency beliefs. This is your assumption about yourself. Some people could know nothing about a certain topic, but they believe in their capabilities enough and their competency enough that they can learn and become effective at whatever they put their minds to. Value, the degree of value you associate with the outcomes. So you will only invest time and effort into something that you value the outcome of, right? There's no point spending time on something that you don't value. Goal orientation, the reasons we pursue goals. Again, this goes back to the previous slide. What motivates you? Is it ego? Is it wanting to impress other people? wanting to feel better about yourself when you compare yourself to other people, or you're driven instinctually just by this want to improve yourself, right? These are questions to ask yourselves constantly. And then epistemology, right? That's a big word. Don't worry, you don't have to remember it. But it's the way you think about acquiring knowledge. Some people are very dogmatic. They believe, oh no, if you didn't go to a good school and university and go through the formal traditional education process, there's no hope for you. Some people believe you're born smart or you're born dumb, right? It's your belief around the acquirement of knowledge. So that's how we break down. Those are the five kind of categories of self-belief. But practically, your belief, your self-belief, your assumed presumption around capability, right? Today, Rob as he is, right? I have assumed presumption around my capability in terms of what I can do, whether I'm trying to cycle or go to gym or be a good father or be a good Christian or be a good presenter on stage, whatever it is. It has been defined by my entire life, all the choices I've made, all the experiences that I have, right? That capability then leads to expected outcome. Based on who I believe I am, I know I can have a certain outcome. Not know I have, it's a presumed assumption again. I go, okay, well, this is who I am. I think I'll be good at presentations, or I think I'll be good at cycling, right? And so you have this belief around what outcome or the result that you can have based on your capability. That then leads to the level of engagement. If I believe I'm absolutely rubbish at cycling, right? And sometimes I feel that, because I'm not built for cycling, right? You compare me and Stacey. Stacey's 20 kilograms lighter than me. She goes up the hill way faster than I can, right? And so if I look in the mirror, I go, well, I'm never going to be a great cyclist. I'm too big, I'm too tall, I'm too heavy, I've got big bones. You have to be skinny to be a cyclist. And so already my level of engagement around cycling can be hampered because I don't have belief in my capability and I understand that I'm not going to have the expected outcome that I would prefer. Yes, I'd love to win the Tour de France. It's not going to happen for me, right? That's my belief system. That then leads to the result. Because now, based on my belief around my capability and the outcome, right, that is going to define what I think the result's going to be, and that is going to define my level of engagement, how much time I invest into something, and that will result in the result. If I believe I'm never going to win the Tour de France, do you think I'm going to go out and train 10 hours a day and try to become a professional cyclist? No. And do you see now that my level of engagement drops? Just based on my belief system, I go, okay, it's never going to happen. So I'm going to cycle socially, right? We do the same thing in life constantly. This process is a loop and it keeps feeding on itself. If you are stuck in your self-belief with regards to capability and what outcome you can achieve, you will never invest and commit to a process to get any further result than what you believe you can get. We have to manipulate those first two aspects. You've got to start challenging yourself on your capability and what you can actually achieve if you want those two, level of engagement and the result, to increase. This is extremely powerful, right? It's called self-awareness. Self-awareness. If you spend 5 minutes with yourself, start asking yourselves questions. What motivates me? What do I think my capabilities are? And how am I going to change them? We are often stuck in the belief, stuck in the mud, so to speak, about what our capabilities are and what outcome we can have. Here's a story of a man. His name's Rich Roll. What a cool name, right? Only an American can have a name like that. Rich Roll, right? So Rich Roll has become a famous podcaster, famous author. His podcasts on iTunes are one of the most highly ranked podcasts on iTunes. About 30 million people have listened to his podcast. He's a man that started out in school like we all did. He was a kid once upon a time. He had braces, he had the headgear, even had an eye patch at school. He performed below par. He never thought much of himself. But what he started to realize after time was that because of that fact, he would have to work harder than perhaps other people that he deemed to be talented. And so he started swimming a little bit in high school. He was never as talented as the other kids. He was a bit slow. But he thought, I'm going to just train harder than anyone else in the school. And he would go do sets in the pool that no one else even came close to. To the extent we actually got into a good university in the States, a swimming scholarship, but he threw it all away. In the next 10 years, he became an alcoholic and a drug addict. He lost all his relationships, family, friends, became a bum, went to jail, drinking and driving, and he qualified, unbelievably, right? So he became a lawyer. He qualified. He got married. He had children, but there were moments where he was so poverty-stricken, he couldn't feed his children. He had no food for groceries. The garbage was, he recounts a very embarrassing story of the garbage just building and building on his pavement because he wasn't paying his rates and taxes. So the garbage collector said, "We're not picking up your garbage." Right? He would have to put all the garbage in his car and then take it to the dump and try sneak it over the wall in the dump because you've got to pay to have garbage processed at the dump. And then all of a sudden, 10 years later, at the age of 40, he was climbing a flight of stairs going to a meeting. And he was so out of breath because he was overweight. He wasn't very healthy. He was so overweight by the time he got to the stairs, he suddenly had this life-changing epiphany. He perhaps didn't realize it then, but he got to the top of the flight of the stairs and he said, "If I carry on like this, I'm going to be dead in the next couple of years." And he decided that he was going to start living a healthier lifestyle. He became a vegan. He started swimming again and he started running again. Right? Small steps based on this sudden life-changing decision, this epiphany that he had. And he became one of the fittest men on the planet in his 40s. I recount the story of when I did Ironman. Has everyone watched that training seminar? I did Ironman. So in 2010 or 2011, I decided I was going to do an Ironman race. An Ironman race is broken down like this. It's a swim, a cycle, and a run, right? All in one day. You start at 7 o'clock in the morning. The cutoff is midnight to finish the race. You've got to swim about 4 kilometers, and then you come out of the sea. So you swim in the ocean, no flat lakes or dams. You swim out in the ocean with the sharks. Then when you finish your swim, you get onto your bicycle, and you cycle 180 kilometers, right? So that takes you between 5 and 8 hours to ride your bicycle, and then you get off your bicycle, and then you start running a marathon. So you've got to run 42 kilometers, right? And so that was my race. This gentleman over here that we see swimming in the water, he did 5 Ironmen in 5 days, back to back, and was one of the top performers. If you go listen to his podcast, he will constantly tell you that he's not talented. He was never talented. But he's developed this relationship, this intimate relationship with pain. With pain. He's able to leverage pain to get him where he wants to be. Right? We have it all in ourselves. You might look in the mirror and go, "I don't have talent." I'm telling you right now, it does not matter. It does not matter. Do not let the circumstances in your life, the choices you've made in life that have led up to today define who you are tomorrow. You get to define who you want to be tomorrow. You have to make that decision first. Right? That's called hope. It has to start with hope and some belief. He's got a tattoo on his arm, which I love. Ego is the enemy. He has realized that if he keeps aspiring and motivating himself based on ego, on what he thinks other people think about him, that motivation is not sustainable. You have to start motivating yourself based on who you want to be and just bettering yourself. Do not worry about what other people think about you or say about you. Guys, just go down the last row. Some important points to remember. Progress equals happiness. Right? This is a truth. This is a truth. If you become stagnant at anything, human desire always is for progress. We look at humans over the last 2,000 years, right? There is just layer upon layer upon layer of progress. You only need to be progressing in one thing in your life. You don't have to progress in everything, right? But if you're not progressing in anything in your life, that stagnation will bleed you dry. You will feel ineffective. It will affect your self-belief. And so, in this business or in life, you need to make sure that you are progressing all the time. The moment you become stagnant, and we see it, you're done. You're done, right? I'll show it to you later in the presentation what stagnation costs you in terms of hard currency, right? We'll look at that a bit later. Passion. This is an excuse so many people use for giving up. I wasn't passionate about it. Have you heard that? I'm struggling to find my passion. We're told, go find your passion. I don't go to work. Work's not work because I'm so passionate about it. I love it, right? All this rubbish. Do you know that passion is derived from a Latin word, passio? Guess what passio means? Suffering. Suffering. So let's take the word passion out of it. Everyone wants to find their passion. Let's replace the word with the real word, suffering. Everyone wants to find their suffering. No, that's not what I said. I'm looking for my passion. I'm looking for something that I love to do. That's rubbish. You're not entitled to some passionate vocation. You have to create it. You have to build it through suffering. So how do you do that? Again, through self-awareness. What motivates you? What do you want in this life? What do you want in this life? For real. And why do you want it? When we start analyzing our self-awareness with regards to what motivates us, with regard to what our aspirations are, we usually start out with these logical reasons why we want it. Right? It might be, well, I want to be rich. I want to be wealthy. Well, why do you want to be rich or wealthy? Because the lifestyle looks great. Well, why do you want a great lifestyle? The more you keep going through those questions, those answers will make a switch. They will go from being logical reasons to suddenly being emotional ones. And the emotional reasons are the true motivation, the true reason why you want to do it. Right? You'll start to get to a point, well, my parents didn't have money, and that made me feel terrible. Right? That's the emotional reason. You have to start becoming aware of what is motivating you. Look at the quote at the bottom. There is no passion to be found in playing small, in settling for a life that is less than the one you are capable of living. I'm going to ask you at the end who said that. Does anyone think they know who said that? No one? Yes. Right? Beautiful quote. Oh, he had so many beautiful quotes, eh? Mandela. Lovely quote from Mandela. So be aware that passion doesn't just arrive on the doorstep. You don't suddenly start doing something and go, oh, wow, I'm passionate about this. You have to find the meaning in what you want out of this life. That is a process, again, of self-awareness. Do you see the theme of today's dev seminar? Self-awareness. Self-awareness. So, practically, what are we going to do? Rob's made up all these points about self-awareness, that you have to start manipulating self-belief so that you understand that you are more capable of who you are today. You don't have to be the same person in 5 years' time. So how do we practically start engaging in this process? Well, in life, in DuePoint, as a wealth engineer, right? Decide, commit, and resolve. Those are the three things we're going to do. Decide, commit, and resolve. Any brand new wealth engineer, this is a process you want to take them through. Make the decision. Decide. Decide that you're going to do this. Are you going to do this or not? People make this decision too quickly. They do. Right? We show them rank 9 holiday. We show them other wealth engineers making money. And they go, yes, that's what I want. It took them 1 second to decide that, yes, that's what they want. Right? But they haven't decided that they need to create the passion for this business if they want to stay sustained in this business that can change their lives. Because we're sending you into a minefield. We're sending you into a minefield. That passion is suffering. You have to go through the suffering to realize that this business can answer a lot of the questions, can help you get to the aspirations that you want. And so the decision is not a quick decision. You have to realize what you're getting yourself into. So in my intro presentation, I often say to people, don't decide what you want. Decide how you're going to fit DuePoint into your life. Because that's the difficulty. If I say to you, I need 2, 3, 4 hours a week from you for DuePoint. Put it in your schedule now. I would love to come to everyone's houses, have a meeting with the whole family and say, your parents have committed to DuePoint. We need this many hours a week. Here's your week schedule. Pick and choose the hours in the week. Right? That is practically how we're going to do this business. And so it's not a fleeting decision. It is a big decision. Because along with that decision is a requirement of commitment. And this is the thing that people miss out on. People don't make the commitment to this business. They don't make a commitment to themselves, right? People are commitment phobes, generally. We don't like to make commitments. Why don't we like to make commitments? Because making any commitment means a loss of freedom, a loss of control. I don't know if I want to commit to being your friend. We might have a fight next week. Then I don't want to be your friend. Right? I don't want to make a commitment to this because maybe the circumstances change. Commitment means I don't have freedom to move. Right? So what is the advantage of commitment? J.K. Chesterton says, the man who makes a vow makes an appointment with himself at some distant time or place. Commitment is a promise to yourself that in 5 years' time, you're not going to be the same person you are today. From DuePoint's point of view, we make a commitment to our wealth engineers. Think about that. In the last almost 3 years, we have delivered on every single promise that we've made. Every single promise. Whether it is a 165 Rand payment or whether it's a 100 and something thousand Rand payment. Whether it's a rank 9 trip, whether it's a car. It doesn't matter what it is. We've delivered on every single promise because when we set out with this business, we said we're going to make a commitment to the people and we take upon that risk. We create this island of certainty for our wealth engineers in a world of uncertainty. You can go, well, at least DuePoint's going to commit to the promises that they've made, right? That's a great thing. When someone can say to another human being, I will stretch myself to make sure that I can guarantee something for you in future, so that you can attach yourself to that commitment. But commitment and trust go hand in hand. So there's a lovely story. You see the trapeze artists? There was a man. What was his name? Henry Nowens. Henry Nowens went out on one of these. I think he was going out on a team building. I think he's a pastor. He's going out on a team building. He lives in San Francisco. He went to the circus. And they were going to teach the people that came to the circus there that day to do the trapeze. Right? And he was like, wow, those are going to be awesome, right? And he was watching the trapeze artists. You've got the catcher, you've got the flyer, and the flyer would fly through the air. And the catcher would catch her, right? And he thought, oh, this is great. And he got told, the flyer, which seems to have the best job, actually is the least important. The catcher does the biggest job. The catcher is the one that catches you. As the flyer, you just have to jump. Jump with your arms stretched out. You have to trust. You have to trust the commitment that the catcher has made that they will catch you. Right? And so he said, okay, that's fine. And he walked up to the platform and he suddenly realized how high it was. And then he looked at where the catcher was and the catcher was all the way there. And he didn't want to jump off the platform. Right? Eventually he built up enough trust. Just enough trust. That the catcher committed to catching him. And he leapt off the platform with his arms stretched out, his eyes closed shut. And suddenly these hands out of nowhere just grabbed him on the wrists and he was flying through the air safely. Right? This is something that we have to commit to. You have to make a commitment to yourself in trusting a business like DuePoint to deliver on its promises. At the same time, you have to make a commitment to yourself whereby you believe that you can become a better person, a better version of yourself tomorrow. Do you have the self-belief to do that? Do you believe that you have the capability to do that? Because from this, what leads on is resolve. We send you into this maze of being a wealth engineer. And perhaps you don't know how to be a wealth engineer when you embark on this thing. There is faith that's required, right, to embark on this journey with DuePoint, but if you have the resolve, if you believe that by never giving up, you will commit yourself to a process of learning and bettering yourself, then you know, okay, I'm going into the maze, but I believe in myself enough to know that I will get through the maze, that I'll reach the aspirations, the goals that I have, because I've got a business that delivers on its promises, and I believe in myself. And when you combine those two things, well, then you can reach any aspiration that you have, right? We take it a step further. You have to start understanding that education is not schooling. It isn't. Because if that is true, well, then you're not going to change. Because schooling is typically over. Who's going to do an MBA in the next couple of years? Oh, see, you're all in trouble. Who's going back to university? Oh, you're all in trouble, right? You have to realize that it is in yourself. Believe that you can develop the necessary skill set to adapt who you are. It is only done by placing yourself in the process. If you stand outside the maze, if you stand on the sidelines, what is going on? Siri. That's a first. I must have said, play Pink Floyd. Right? You have to immerse yourself in the process. If you stand on the sidelines, if you don't develop the trust to make the commitment to become intimately involved in the process, that's all that happens. You stagnate. You have to be experiencing the pain, the suffering, the passion to be able to put yourself through, I want to say, the kiln. You know, when they make the vases, the pottery kiln. You've got to experience that fire, right? If you want to change. And so believe that it is in you. You have the ability to change. At the end of the day, only results matter. At the end of the day, you're either earning money from DuePoint or you're not. Because that's what matters at the end of the day. You can say, yes, I commit to this whole process. But at the end of the day, you cannot lie to yourself about the results. If you are motivated by ego, you will lie to yourself about the results because you're more worried about what other people think instead of the process that you put yourself through. Be prepared for failure along the way. Placing yourself in that maze is going to lead to failure. It is the only way that you learn is through the failure, right? Do not be afraid of failure. Failure is if you're in the process and you don't learn anything from it. Because if you're not learning, you're not bettering yourself. If you're not bettering yourself, you're not becoming a better version of yourself. Then you're not capable of changing. So believe this, right? Failure is also giving up. It's putting your hand up in the maze and say, take me out. I don't want to do this anymore. That is failure. But always be honest about your results in this business. Because it's your ability to reflect on the results, to at the end of the month go, I earned this much, or I earned that much, or my earnings went down, or they went up, and reflecting on that and going, okay, well, what did I learn out of the process? Our DuePoint app tells you what the results are. That's why we created the DuePoint app. Because it tells you in real time what's happening in your business. It tells you whether you are bringing good or bad quality into DuePoint. It tells you whether you're growing or not, whether you're shrinking. It tells you whether you're earning money while you're sleeping, right? It tells you how much closer you are to rank 9. These are all explicit results. There's nothing lost in translation when you open up that app. The app is black and white data, right? And that's why it's so important to know our app. Our app's not this gimmicky thing that just tells you whether people are paying their debit orders or not. It is the ability for you to reflect on whether you're being effective or not, right? So I go back to a business study, a Harvard Business School study that was made where they kind of analyzed all these brand new businesses, right? Because majority of entrepreneurs fail. And what they were able to do was actually build a list of why entrepreneurs failed. This is very valuable because this is not opinion, this is based on fact. So there's 7 reasons why most entrepreneurs fail. This is something we can reflect on because we've gone through this whole dev seminar, right? Well, let's see if it's accurate. Lack of focus. Lack of focus could be a lack of commitment, right? There's the next point. Lack of motivation, commitment, and passion. People weren't willing to suffer. They weren't willing to make the commitment. Their motivation to why they were doing this was perhaps skewed. Perhaps they were just trying to impress their mates around them. Look, I'm a business owner. I'm a CEO, right? Too much pride, again, motivated by ego. Too much pride. We see it in this business often. Do you know how many people we've invited up onto Tell All Tuesday say, no, they're not coming up because their earnings aren't high enough. They're worried about what people will think. That immediately is evident that you're motivated by what people think, right? I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm saying it is an opportunity to become a little more self-aware about what's motivating you. Taking advice from the wrong people. How many people tell us what they think they know about everything in life? Right? Especially as a network marketer, you go out and everybody's telling you this and that and come join this and why are you doing that? Your family tells you you're crazy. You're part of a pyramid scheme. Stop listening to everybody else, right? Why would you take advice from random people? Don't. Look for good mentorship. What is happening on this stage right now? Good mentorship. Someone who has your best interests at heart. Right? A business where there's no competitiveness. There's just the willingness for people to work together and collaborate so that we can be the best version of ourselves tomorrow. Lack of general and domain-specific business knowledge. That means you don't know what the hell you're doing. This is training, again. It's training, right? This might not be so much DuePoint operational training, but we've got all of that already. Are you aware of all the training that we have on our YouTube channel under tools on your app? That allows you to increase your general and domain-specific knowledge about the business that you're engaging in that is a proponent of trying to help you change your life. So become aware of everything. You have to become an expert in this field. And then raising too much money, right? You don't have to worry about that because DuePoint, the business, takes on all that risk. We take on all the risk. We spend 150,000 rand every single month maintaining our IT systems. Our rent is 200,000 rand. We're the ones that commit to taking rank nines to the best holiday possible every single year. We commit to buying the car for our rank 11s. We commit to paying every single wealth engineer at the end of the month. We make all those commitments. We take on that risk. We create this island of certainty in the world of uncertainty for our wealth engineers. And so you don't even have to worry about the last line, right? The price of not doing your best. So now you say, well, Rob, you know, I'm not one of those one percenters. I'm quite happy just getting a B. A B is good, right? 75% at school is great. Don't listen to government. If you aspire to just passing, you're not going anywhere, right? But now you can say to me, well, aspiring to 75%, that's quite good. That was me. That's been me my entire life. I'm quite happy to get to 75% and just cruise. But what is the cost of that, right? Why do we have to aspire to becoming a one percenter? So here we've got an example. So this example is based on data. It's based on facts. So let's say every November and December and January, you were just tired. It's the end of the year. There's a heat wave. You can't go out talking to people. You're tired. And you decide, well, November, December, and January, I'm just not going to do any work. I'm not going to grow my first point, right? So now you're working only 75% of the year. But that's still good. 75% still working hard, isn't it? Well, you have to reflect on the results. The results is what matters, right? And the result of only working the 9 months of every year results in over a five-year period, right? So over a five-year period, so this is based on doing two new people every month. So we take that little example of connecting two people every month. So now you, for 3 months, you're not connecting two new people. So that's six people that you're not connecting once a year. You do that for 5 years, that's 30 first pointers that you've not put into your first point, right? So there you say, 30 first pointers lost. It results in a 50% less return just on your first point. So now you have suffered a loss of return, of money, of 51% after a five-year period. It becomes worse because if you look at your whole channel, it results in a nearly 70% loss in your entire channel over the same period. Working at 75% will result in 70% loss. Why? Because our business is based on compounding. On a compounding effect. It's an effect that you want to take advantage of. Again, it's like debt. If you decide only to work a little bit, it means like you're almost indebted. And when you're indebted, you know that there's a big interest rate connected to indebtedness. You want to be creating wealth. And so if you operate 12 months of the year, your income will be 70% higher in 5 years' time. Again, I want you to take self-awareness away. Do you let yourself get away with taking a couple of months off? Do you let it happen? It is costing you. It is costing you results. What does that do? When your results are affected, it affects your self-belief. It doesn't go unhindered. It has a direct consequence of what you think your capability is. It has a direct effect of what you think your self-belief is. And what that does is it then affects the level of engagement and investment you will make into the process. Because in 5 years' time, after doing this business, 75% of the year you go, has it really been worth it? Am I really geared to do this business? Am I good at being a wealth engineer? Yes, you would have been, but you compromised on the commitment that you made when you joined the business. But who do we blame at the end of the process? You never blame yourself. We never blame ourselves. Why not? Why don't we blame ourselves? Because it's too difficult to blame yourself. You try to turn a blind eye to the effect that it has on your self-belief, right? But it does it anyway. You can't escape it. Be aware of this. It's a decision that you're going to make. I'm not going to force everyone to work every single month of the year, but you have to realize the consequence so that when you ask yourself the question, why am I earning this and everyone is earning that? I hope you don't blame the system. Engineering wealth practically. So now how do we apply all of this practically? What I want you to do is understand that DuePoint is very simple. We break it down into the supply chain processes. Whenever I have a wealth engineer come to me and start crying about their business, I break it down exactly like this. So on my whiteboard in the office, this is what I do. I say there is a process at DuePoint, right? The first step of the process is your ability to go out and prospect. Speak to people, right? Whether it's friends, acquaintances, strangers, it doesn't matter. Colleagues, you're going to run out of people you know. Let me just tell you that. Go ask Donnie or any of the wealth engineers that have been here for a while, Patrick and Pumi. They ran out of people they know long ago, right? You still have to prospect. You are going to be making lists. You're going to be calling people and saying, give me some names because I need names. It is your lifeblood here at DuePoint. It is followed then by the pitch. What is the pitch? It's what you say to the person that's on the list. So you might WhatsApp them, you might email them, hopefully you call them. Hopefully you meet them in person if they're close enough to you, right? And you are going to deliver a pitch. It is probably the most fundamental step in the business, right? Because it's such a broad gray area. What do I say? You have to adapt what you say to who you're speaking to. You can't deliver the same pitch word for word verbatim to every single person, right? You have to be a little bit flexible. You've got to develop these social skills, these soft skills. You've got to connect to what people are feeling. Always try to address what people need in their lives, right? It begins with a little bit of conversation. Dr. Benfield, Brendan's dad, always said a good salesperson is someone who can just tell a good story. They don't actually do selling. They just connect with the other person, right? And so the pitch, well, there's lots of improvement around the pitch. And then all you have to do is press play. Once you've delivered a successful pitch, the person will say, yes, okay, I've got 20 minutes or I've got 45 minutes or I'll come with you to head office, right? It ends in you pressing play. You just press play. And then suddenly, Rob jumps on stage and delivers a presentation for you, free of charge. Or Brendan, right? So that's probably the easiest part of the process. And then you grow. So the success out of having someone watch the intro presentation is that some of them will join your first point and you experience this growth on your first point. And then the final step to this process is your ability to leverage the compounding effect at DuePoint. It is duplication. These people that joined your first point, you are now relying on them to go and build your channel further. And so you have duplication. So these are the steps. It's that simple, right? If you experience any difficulty in your business, all I do is you come into my office, I lay out these steps, I say, tell me how you're doing each of these steps. Tell me where you are struggling. Because you can document every single step. You can say, well, this is my list. So I'm not running out of list. I've always got a list. I've always got people to speak to. This is the pitch I use. I say, okay, how many people are you pitching to? And how many people are agreeing to come watch the intro? There's a ratio there. So now you've got a number. You've got a result that you can reflect on. Out of the people that watch the intro presentation, how many are joining? Then you can say, Rob, you're doing a bad job because only 1 out of 10. Right? Or maybe it's something you're saying after the intro presentation, right? Again, you have liberty to evaluate every single step. And it's as simple as that because there is room for improvement every single step in this process. Be aware of this. Do not feel lost in the process. If you feel lost in the process, lean into the support at DuePoint. That is my job. My job is to support you, right? To collaborate with you. You are my business partners. I want to see you successful because if you're not successful, I can't be successful. Don't get lost. This little business that we have here in Bryanston, that is national, is this little island of certainty. I want you to feel safe when you come to DuePoint, right? If you're feeling unsafe, speak to us. Speak to us. That's all required. So be your best and become a one percenter. Why would you aspire to anything less? Decide you're really doing this. Decide you're really doing this. Some of you wealth engineers might have to do this process again. You're going to have to go home today and go, okay, this is, I want to change my life. I want to. Why? Why? Get down to the emotion because that emotion is the reason that you're going to connect to constantly that motivates you. You might not even be aware of it. It happens intrinsically, whether you're aware of it or not. It's only through self-awareness and questioning to become to realize what actually motivates us. And then say to yourself, can DuePoint take me there? Can it? You might come to the answer and go, well, no, DuePoint's not what I want to do. The decision is not, yes, you have to make the decision to join DuePoint. The decision is, do you want to do DuePoint? Do you want to do DuePoint? Trust DuePoint and make a commitment to yourself and to the process. We're not competing against everyone else. You're competing against yourself. Every single day you compete against yourself. We don't realize it. Be open to learning, right? To understanding that you can improve, that you can become a better version of yourself. Be patient with yourself and your channel. Be patient. You got all the time in the world. DuePoint's not running anywhere. We're not going to cancel rank 9 after this rank 9 trip next week. It's waiting for you. Be patient, right? Because if you put too much pressure on yourself, you will buckle under the pressure. There is no pressure at DuePoint. Show yourself and your channel how it's done. One day at a time. Show them how it's done. Oh, people cling to people that exude positive energy about where they're going, what they're doing. The engagement, the passion, the suffering they're willing to endure. Did you see that lady running through the stadium? The crowd was on its feet. Anyone who was in that stadium doesn't remember who won the race. They remember the lady that came 36th, that refused to give up. What kind of a leader are you in your business? Are you the one that just buckles under pressure constantly? Is not willing to suffer for anything? Doesn't want to commit? Doesn't want to give up their freedom. Oh, I want to join that business. I'm going to join that business too. It looks good over there. I'm not making any commitment over here. I want to be free. I want to be flexible. Right? You've just compromised yourself. Whoops. And that's it, guys. It is simple as that. We've got to ask ourselves the question, what do we want? Self-awareness is one of the biggest things. It all starts with self-awareness. And this belief in yourself that you can become anyone you want to be. You are not the person you see in the mirror based on everything and everything that you've done and all the choices you've made before you. Because if you believe that, you aren't going to change. I'm telling you right now, if you believe that the person you see in the mirror is the person you're stuck with, life is not going to change for you. Look in the mirror and go, I'm making an appointment with this person in 5 years' time. In 5 years' time, I'm going to be sitting on the beach in Mauritius with my family, feeling great about myself. Imagine when that day arrives, when you can look back and go, wow, 2, 3, 4 years ago, I was earning nothing. Now I'm earning 20, 25,000 rand, sitting in business class with my kids. My kids think I'm a superhero. Right? This is the promise that we're making to you. This is the commitment I, DuePoint, make to you. If you're willing to engage in this process, I will do this for you. We as a business will do this for you. Guys, I hope you've taken some value out of this, even if it's just one or two principles that you can take home, reflect on. What is the time? Oh, and I'm finished before 10 o'clock. I'm so impressed with myself. All right, guys, go out and do it. This is on YouTube already, right? We've got a handful of people here. We've got perhaps 3 or 4 times as many people watching the live stream, but there are thousands of wealth engineers that haven't watched this. So go to your first points and tell them, go watch training on Saturday. It was a goodie. All right, go and do it. Good luck.